The Philippine Tax Bureau maintains there will be no extension in the April 15 deadline for the filing of annual income tax returns. The agency urges taxpayers to use the BIR's online services, saying they are available 24/7.
Napakainit po ng panahon, eh. Kaya naman na masisigurado po natin na itong online facilities natin ay gumagana po. Binabantayan po natin yan at doon sa mga magbigay ng extra na mga security para naman masigurado na talagang gagana yan at hindi magda-down ang ating system. Sa filing, alam naman natin na magdadagsa po ngayong mga panahon na to ang gagamit po ng online facilities. At patuloy din po ang aming information systems group dito po sa BIR na tutukan at bantayan ang any form of hacking.
Metro Manila local governments will shift to a 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. work schedule on May 2nd instead of April 15. San Juan City Mayor and Metro Manila Council President Francis Zamora cites a need for more time to disseminate the new work hours to the public. The Metropolitan Manila Development Authority also clarifies the modified working hours are not rigid. The MMDA says government agencies can still implement other schedules which suit their needs. The shift of working hours is part of government's efforts to ease traffic congestion in the region during rush hour.
Yung 7 to 4 naman po, general rule po yun. Pero pwede naman po mag-adjust ang MTU, ang mga government agencies. Kung ano yung suited sa kanila, meron pong nagsasabi na mas preferred nila yung 4-day work week. Pero ang nakasentro po ito na 7 o'clock, magsisimula na po yung servisyo publiko. Tapos po ng 4. Yung iba naman po, ang gagawing 4-day work week, tapos alternate po. Para lang po maikalat yung ating mga empleyado sa mas maraming oras o araw para po hindi po magkasabay-sabay sa pag-commute.
Meanwhile, the Metro Manila Council says some government workers will still stay in their offices until 5 in the afternoon to cater to the public as they adjust to the new schedule.
Hindi naman po makakadisrupt sa serbisyo ng lungsod ang isang oras. At mag-iiwan naman po tayo ng skeletal force from 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. for frontline services dahil baka meron pa rin mga darating po between 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. Asahan po nila na meron pa rin skeletal workforce na may iwan po sa City Hall.
The Philippine government files a petition to take over the operations of the Manila-Cavite Toll Expressway, or Cavitex. The toll road is run by the Cavite Infrastructure Corporation, which is under the Manny Pangilinan-led Metro Pacific Tollways Corporation. The government insists CIC's authority to operate and maintain Cavitex expired back in 2021. It adds government is missing out on huge revenue from toll collections. Under the joint venture agreement with the government, the revenue sharing ratio should shift from 90-10 to 60-40 once CIC recovers its investments.
Sana ay makuha natin to dahil it will really benefit the Filipino people. Imagine kapag 60-40 na ang hatian in favor of the government. Yun binabayaran toll ng ating mga motorista dyan sa Cavitex ay bababa, considerably bababa.
In a statement, Metro Pacific said the company has already been meeting with government to discuss their concerns on the revenue sharing. It added the court action will be responded to properly.
Some bad news for motorists. Oil prices seen rising for a fourth straight time next week. The Philippine Energy Department expects gas prices to increase by up to 20 centavos, while diesel and kerosene may climb as much as 1 peso on Tuesday. The DOE still attributes the higher pump prices to the ongoing conflict in the Middle East. Business confidence in the Philippines less upbeat in the first quarter of this year. That's according to the Philippine Central Bank's latest business expectations survey report. The BSP says overall confidence index dropped to 33.1% from 35.9% in the fourth quarter last year. However, business sentiment for the next quarter is more bullish due to expected higher demand for products and services, the seasonal summer uptick in business activities for the tourism and fisheries sectors, and easing inflation. Businesses also expect the Philippine peso to appreciate against the U.S. dollar, but they believe inflation and peso borrowing rates may rise in the first half of the year.
Filipino consumers turned less optimistic on the economy in the first quarter of the year. Based on the BSP's Consumer Expectation Survey, the overall confidence index remained in the negative, but improved to negative 10.9%. Monetary authorities say the improved outlook is due to expectations of additional and higher income and the availability of more jobs, among others. But consumer outlook for the second quarter and for the next year turned gloomier in anticipation mainly of higher inflation. The BSP survey also found Filipinos still expect borrowing rates to go up and for the Philippine peso to weaken against the U.S. dollar. The Philippine Franchise Association confident it will hit its growth targets this year despite some challenges of scaling up businesses here and abroad. Jackie Pascual reports.
The Franchise Asia Philippines Expo opens in Pasay with over 700 participants. Senator Mark Villar, chairperson of the Committee on Trade, Industry and Entrepreneurship, says with over 1,800 brands, the Philippines is the biggest franchise market in Southeast Asia, and it is expected to grow even further.
2022 alone, this industry has contributed 7.8% of the country's GDP and has generated roughly 2 million direct and indirect jobs for our countrymen.
He says the food and beverage franchise subsector contributed $10.8 billion to the economy, and the non-food retail and services contributed $1.34 billion. The Philippine Franchise Association sees about 8 to 10% growth this 2024. This includes the entry of more foreign players.
We see, you know, many Malaysian, Taiwanese, Korean brands wanting to enter here. There are also American franchise brands that want to enter.
PFA, however, wants more Filipino companies to expand overseas, but government needs to step in and help amid the many challenges of scaling up businesses here and abroad.
We want to get more Filipino global brands. So gusto natin mas marami tayo mga franchise brands that go international. And for this, we need a lot of government support. It's very expensive to join a lot of these shows and expos.
The tax incentive programs. Now, what are the concessions being given? Access to funding. Kasi ang taas ng interest rates ngayon for loans if you want to expand your business. Secondly is the compliances in terms of FDA, no, for food and the cosmetic sector.
The group is happy with the interest of the public in franchising, saying the sector continues to evolve, like the growth of coffee shop business, which has now developed into various segments and price points. But for those just starting, they have this advice.
Start with a small one. Don't get into something big if you're just starting, diba? Kasi what the difficulty of starting big, you have a lot of, not only resources, but the capital also, requirements.
Big and small companies have various packages that will suit investors' needs, like a donut company offering a trial program of 6 months for interested franchisees. Another fast food company, meanwhile, wants to increase the number of its franchise stores.
Business trial program, hindi mo kailangan maglabas muna ng malaking halaga. All you need to prepare is at least 100,000 pesos. 50,000 don is refundable. So for 3 to 6 months,
you want more. In the next 5 years, we are planning to open additional 300 stores, and 60% of which would be franchise stores.
The Franchise Expo will last until Sunday, and organizers urge the public to consider franchising as one option to become an entrepreneur. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
Here are some local corporate headlines. Lucio calls Costco Capital's full-year earnings in 2023 nearly flat as the aggressive expansion of its grocery business tempered overall growth. The company says its bottom line only grew 1% last year, despite an 8.8% climb in revenue. Its retail businesses, Pure Gold and SNR, accounted for 69% of total earnings, while its liquor segment brought in 24%. As for Andrew Tan's Global Estate Resorts, it saw a modest 3% growth in its bottom line last year. GERI cites strong real estate sales as well as hotel and leasing operations. The company currently has 9 tourism estates and integrated lifestyle communities across the country. And finally, Ayala Corporation is fully redeeming 4 billion pesos worth of Series A bonds due in May. The bond shall be redeemed in cash with the redemption price set at 100% the issue prices, plus all accrued and unpaid interest based on the coupon rate of around 3% per annum.
The Philippines, U.S., and Japan wrap up their historical trilateral summit in Washington, with the allies agreeing to further deepen their maritime and security cooperation amid China's aggressive incursions in the South China Sea. Tokyo and Washington also vowed to pour in investments to Manila to help make the Southeast Asian country more resilient. Katrina Domingo reports.
The Philippines, Japan, and the United States will work to build an open and free Indo-Pacific. This is what President Joe Biden told his Filipino and Japanese counterparts during their first trilateral summit, where Manila, Tokyo, and Washington condemned China's illegal and dangerous actions in the South China Sea.
A great deal of history in our world will be written in the Indo-Pacific over the coming years. As the three allies, three steadfast partners, and three proud democracies representing a half a billion people, today we commit to writing that story in the future together. To building the Indo-Pacific that is free, open, prosperous, and secure for all.
Among the initial steps to achieve this goal, the conduct of more combined naval and maritime exercises. Washington is expected to train some American, Filipino, and Japanese personnel aboard a U.S. Coast Guard vessel this year, while fresh drills will be held around Japan in 2025. Biden also reiterated a stipulation from the Mutual Defense Treaty that the U.S. will come to the aid of its allies in the event of an armed attack.
The United States' defense commitments to Japan and to the Philippines are ironclad. Any attack on Philippine aircraft, vessels, or armed forces in the South China Sea would invoke our Mutual Defense Treaty.
Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos adds this closer cooperation involving the three countries will help secure a safer future for the region.
It is a partnership born not out of convenience nor of expediency, but as a natural progression of a deepening relation and robust cooperation amongst our three countries, linked by a profound respect for democracy, good governance, and the rule of law.
For Japanese Prime Minister Fumio Kishida, it is very natural for the Philippines, Japan, and the U.S. to become allies as the three countries adhere to the rule of law.
In the midst of compound crisis faced by the global community, multi-layered cooperation between allies and like-minded countries is essential if we are to maintain and bolster a free and open international order based on the rule of law. Today's meeting will make history as an occasion that significantly pushed forward such initiative.
The three allies will also launch humanitarian assistance and disaster response exercises in the future. Despite this show of force from the trilateral summit, China continues to insist that Manila should seek Beijing's permission before bringing fresh supplies to soldiers stationed in the Ayungin Shoal. The Chinese embassy in Manila, for its part, says the U.S. is not a party to the South China Sea issue and is not in the position to interfere in issues between Manila and Beijing. It adds the recent tension in the South China Sea would not have occurred without the U.S. egging on the Philippines. On the economic front, Tokyo and Washington have agreed to help Manila build the Luzon Economic Corridor, a series of development projects that will link Subic, Clark, Manila, and Batangas. Japan and the U.S. will also allot some $8 million to establish an open radio access network, or ORAN, system, which will make communications in the Philippines more secure and reliable. Efforts will also be made to boost the Philippines' safe and peaceful use of nuclear energy and the semiconductor industry through the training of Filipino personnel in specialty institutions in Japan and the U.S. While the first trilateral summit was well received inside the White House, some groups trooped outside the U.S.'s seat of power in protest of Marcos Jr.'s alleged compliance to sell the Philippines to foreigners.
The trilateral summit has been described as historic and the first of its kind for the Philippines. But one question still remains on how the operational details of these deals would actually affect Filipinos on the ground. Katrina Domingo, ABS-CBN News, Washington, D.C.
President Marcos also met with Google executives in Washington in line with his administration's digital transformation vision for the Philippines. Google Global Vice President Karan Bhatia says they discussed possible additional infrastructure investments by the tech giant to further improve internet connectivity in the country.
Some of the specific areas we talked about included some of the infrastructure investments that we have already made in the Philippines, including on subsea cables that are connecting the Philippines to the rest of the world, enabling ongoing growth of the Philippines' internet industry, YouTube creators. So a lot of good discussion there about some of the things that we are been doing and things that we would like to consider continuing to do.
The International Monetary Fund says inflation is easing faster than expected, but it has not been fully defeated. IMF Chief Kristalina Georgieva says headline inflation for advanced economies was at 2.3% at the end of 2023, down from 9.5% 18 months ago. The downward trend is expected to continue this year, which could lead central banks to begin cutting rates in the second half of the year. But she urges central banks to calibrate their policy decisions. She also warns of weak global economic growth, adding rising debt levels pose a major challenge to public finances in many countries.
We need good policies more than ever. Making the right policy choices will define the future of the world economy. On this final stretch, it is doubly important that central banks uphold their independence. As we know, policy credibility is vital in the fight to restore price stability. Where necessary, policymakers must resist calls for premature interest rate cuts, because premature easing can see new inflation surprises that may even necessitate a further bout of monetary tightening. And we have to recognize, on the other side, delaying too long could pour cold water on economic activity.
China remains confident its imports and exports remain in the growth channel in the first half of the year, despite shrinking trade in March. The Chinese Customs Bureau cites improving global trade. Policymakers have been rolling out support measures to bolster a shaky economic recovery. On Wednesday, China received a negative downgrade on its sovereign credit rating from Fitch, which cited economic uncertainties.